Welcome back to the Mixtape Show, and we got a special guest calling in on the other line. And if you guys listen to the show every week, which I know you do, man, you hear this man's voice with one of the dopest segments, probably the only type of segment that you'll hear on radio, man. We got The Beat Goes In, and with the calling himself, we got the homie Divine Thought. What's good, brother? What's good?
Hey, what's good, homie? Man. Been a long time coming.
I know it, man. I know it, man. Like I said, we talk off air all the time, bro. So it feels comfortable talking to you on air, but it feels weird at the same time because this is a different type of format. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. I've had people request it. So
Yeah, man. Well, first and foremost, man, brother, thank you for that. The Beat Goes In segment, man. I have people hit me up all the time, man. And they love the knowledge that you put out there and the jewels that you put out there. And actually, one of my artists that I work with, they just released a project, Loose Cannons, and they said that, when they was releasing the project and trying to figure out where to put it at, one of the jewels that you dropped was about the, you know, putting it out on Spotify and Apple Music and all of that, and how, you know, those are tied into the labels, and, you know, they remembered that jewel and was like, nope, we're going to do this independently and just put it out on our own platforms and kind of build it that way, man. And they've been seeing a lot of success from that just because it's bringing the audience to them. And they get to reap the benefits of that, man. So they personally told me to tell you, man, they appreciate these jewels that you've been dropping, brother.
Yeah, man, I appreciate the people who actually take time to listen, too. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, in this day and age, you don't get a lot of people who are willing to just talk freely about the business. Because the people who are actually in the business, they tend to keep quiet. Like, there's mm-hmm. a lot of shit that, like, they don't like to get into for certain reasons, politics and whatnot. Me, you know... Mm-hmm. I just like to talk, you know what I mean? Yeah. If I can help anybody, and if they truly want to listen, it's good to see and hear that people are actually taking heed to some of it, especially in this day and age, man.
Exactly, man. So I'll tell you what we're going to do, man. We're gonna break this up in two parts, man. We're going to break this up into Divine Thought as the MC and the artist, and then Divine Thought as working in the behind the scenes on the music industry. So let's start with the artist part, man. Dope MC, okay. Brother. When'd you start doing that, man? When'd you start rhyming, and what kind of got you into rhyming and creating music?
Well, I started, I'd say, 1996. I was actually, I took part in a radio event for a radio station called Q102. Mm-hmm. It was a Philadelphia station. And they had a talent event. And, you know, I got on stage at that point, you know, young boy, but got on stage. And it's just ever since then, I kind of, and through the whole time I was making music, I'd say that time right there was the first time that I had to take, because I was writing music, I was doing my thing, but kind of young. So when I first got on stage, I got the taste of what it would be like on stage and everything else, and it just kind of went from there.
Yeah, and you from that Northeast area too originally, right?
Yeah, I'm from the tri-state area, you know, Delaware, Jersey, that area. So mm-hmm. I mean, it's Philly. Yeah. So it's one of them things that, like, you know, I always kind of had that energy.
That's definitely key in a lot of these conversations we about to have, because me and him, man, we from the same school, from that East Coast school, so a lot of our loves of hip hop is tied into that. So we may get a little biased in this interview, man. So you was doing your thing, you know, got on stage and all that stuff, man, and started writing rhymes. And when'd you put out your first official project?
I'd say first official project was probably the mixtape. The mm-hmm. first mixtape I put out, which was 1999, uh-huh. something like that, put out a mixtape. And, you know, back then, it was a lot different. You had websites like DatPiff mm-hmm. and that kind of thing where, I mean, you could use industry beats and rhyme over them, and it wasn't this big crime that it is now. Like, you mm-hmm. know what I mean? Mm-hmm. The internet was more open in a lot of ways back then. I know it don't seem like it because it seems like it's more open now, but it was more open and honest back then in a lot of different ways when it comes to making music. So, like, you know, I put it out, and but when it came to actually making music, I would say my first release was probably 2003.
Okay. All right. Now, how'd you feel about it? Is that, like you said, the internet was open, the technology started shifting a little bit. When did the business hit you? When did you realize, oh shit, this is really a business? This is not me making music and enjoying that part.
Well, actually came before my first release because the mixtapes got the attention of the labels. Like, you know, and being on stage, and even the times when I had the mixtapes, I had a few little songs that I had, like little singles that I would go and do on stage or like whatever. But it wasn't like I was doing official, like I copy wrote the music and put it out and got disc makers. Like, it wasn't like a full project, but there was times where I made singles and stuff. It kind of got on top of that with the mixtapes. It got the attention of the labels. So I realized a lot about the business at a young age. So I'd say around 18, 19 years old, that's when I figured out a lot about the business, because I was in meetings with labels and actually sitting down, like in, from the day where you actually had to go outside. I know I say that a lot on these segments, man. The people get tired of me telling them to go outside, man. Like, I get told that, like, why are you always telling people to go outside? It's because nobody do anymore. They stay on their phone and everything. But back in the day, and I hate to sound like that old dude, but back in the day when you had to go outside and actually put boots on the ground and go to physical places like offices and labels and radio stations and talk with DJs and all of that, because that was really the only way to get put out. The internet wasn't the way it is now, where you had all these social networks and everything else, and you really had to go outside and learn the business the hard way, like, you know. So I'd say learning the business at a young age, that really help. I mean, of course, I made the mistakes I made, but at the end of the day, that really helped me going forward into knowing what I know now with everything.
So take me to those meetings, man. What was that experience like? I know it's not what we see online, where people, you know, pretend that they up at Def Jam and taking pictures in front of the logo like they really having these meetings. So take us inside of that meeting and that, you know what I'm talking about, in that experience.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
And that experience of being in those meetings and meeting those label heads. How was that experience for you?
Yeah, it wasn't as colorful as it seems. Like, everybody talk about how they was in these boardrooms, and I hear that a lot. Even my critics, they talk about how, like, you know, they did this and they did that, and they was in boardrooms with executives. Once they start saying all of that, I know they're bullshit. Because when you first come in the door, you don't get to see the boardrooms and all of that. You sit in the office and you wait your fucking turn. That's how it happens. Like, you know what I mean? You wait your turn and you sit there wondering what the fuck is going to happen. Like, you know what I mean? The nerves start to hit you and everything like that. So basically, you're sitting there in the office, and if you have representation with you, the representation is sitting there with you, trying to tell you what to say, what not to say, what they're going to handle, like, you know, what they're comfortable with doing, what they're not comfortable with doing. And then when you get called back there, you normally get told about the big wig, and you sit there and talk to an assistant, where you talk to somebody who they sent out there to talk to you. And then they do a lot of good cop, bad cop shit, where, like, you know, they say certain things and how they're going to give you the world, and all you got to do is this, and they heard your music and like the way your numbers are trending and everything else. But when they sit there and they put the contract in front of you, that's a real pivotal moment. That's going to decide whether you're, that moment right there is, that's going to be the moment of truth where you know if you're smart or if you're stupid. Regardless, it's going to tell you a lot about the representation that you got, the manager, and everything else. Because back then, I always thought, like, getting a industry manager, somebody who's been there, done that, that's going to be a good thing. I thought that the more they cost, the better they would be. The more experience that they have with major labels, the more that's going to serve me. And then you get to learn that's the opposite. They're in the label's pockets. They've dealt with these executives before, so they're not really in the best interest of you. They're in the best interest for them and them getting future work with that label. And I found that out the hard way when I was sitting down there with the manager, who was telling me all of these terms are all good in the contract. It's like a 40-page contract.
Yeah.
And they telling me all of this shit, like, you know what I'm saying, about how I'm going to be the next white rapper and all of this stuff and all of these gimmicks and everything else that they have planned for me, right?
Oh, so and they already had like your trajectory or what they want to do with you when you sat in that meeting.
Oh yeah.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, they already had it all set up. And I'll say who it was. It was Interscope.
Uh-huh.
Like, you know, I can't go into too many names or whatever, but at the end of the day, they already had because they already had Slim Shady, right?
Yeah.
So they was trying to kind of piggyback on that. And a lot of people don't believe me, but me and his career kind of overlapped a little bit there in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
For real. Like, a lot of the same people that dealt with him and all of that, I was dealing with.
Okay.
So when they sat down and they were saying, you know, all of these kind of gimmicks that I was going to be, I was like, man, that don't really suit me though. Like, I'm an MC. I'm not a white rapper. I don't fucking do all that race shit. Like, fuck yeah. Is that about? Like, I'm just an MC.
Yeah.
And I'm definitely not going to make music that you want me to make. I'm going to make the music I want to make.
Yeah.
And I had that, like, real innocent, like, honest thought that's how music was made.
Mm-hmm.
That you just have talent, and then you sit down with the labels, and they either like what you do or don't like what you do, but then they sign you based on what you do.
Yeah.
And that's not the case at all.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting there going through a 40-page contract, and I'm signing, I'm initialing, and you got to sign a lot of different times.
Yeah.
So I'm going through the pages, and I'm like, and I just see the shit start sounding real weird, like advance recoup, all these label terms. And I'm looking at the manager like, yo, are you sure this is what it is? Like,
yeah.
And he's like, yeah, yeah, just do it. So I'm like, man, I don't know. And mind you, I'm halfway through the contract. So I'm like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I really don't know if this is a good look. So then I bailed. And I was told at that time that I will never work. I will never work again in the business as an artist.
Mm.
And good luck. And at that time, it wasn't like you could have this big independent career or something like that, where you could just say, fuck the big label, I'ma just go ahead and do it on my own and that kind of thing. It's not really like that back then. It was one of those, like, they really could fuck your whole career up.
Wow.
Like, they really could. And it's a very small business.
Wow.
So
let me ask you this real quick, man. If when you, as an artist, when you go into these type of meetings, and if you could put a number on it, man, how much control and leverage does that artist really have when he walks into these meetings for these labels to have, you know, to talk about these contracts?
Well, that varies with
a percentage on it.
Yeah, that varies with the, I'd say, era too.
Mm-hmm.
Back then when I was doing it, you might be able to have 40%, depending on your numbers, depending on, okay, because back in the day, you would be able to go on stage and perform and get mm-hmm. that backing from wherever you were performing at. And then this is something artists don't realize nowadays, because it still applies. This kind of thing still applies. They just don't do it. You go on stage, get that backing of the people, and then you go to something like Disc Makers. I know physicals ain't out now. I'm talking about back then.
Mm-hmm.
Go to Disc Makers, get your disc pressed up, get the barcodes on them. The more you got them joints scanned, that's numbers that you bring as tangible evidence,
mm-hmm.
right? And back then, they would look at online numbers from DatPiff and different things like that, and they would take those numbers into consideration. So if you had a lot of discs sold, and you had a lot of people that you were performing in front of, they would look at what you've already done and say, well, if he has or she has this much support doing this, I could put me as a big label, I could put my machine behind this and double and triple and quadruple down. And the more that you had coming in, of course, if you registered your music for track airplay with radio, and you were getting radio spins and that kind of thing, and they could see those Nielsen numbers, that would be another thing that they would take into account when you're going into those meetings. So the more that you had going in, I would say the better it would be for you sitting down and talking to these execs, if you knew how to leverage that. And if your manager was really for you at that point, then if they knew how to leverage that, and then you could get a better contract for yourself. But a lot of times, even with that, they didn't really, a lot of artists didn't realize. That's why all the old heads now, you hear the stories, they got sucked into bad contracts and everything like that, because they really, some of them even had those numbers and they didn't know how to leverage it, right? Mm-hmm. They ain't no school for this. They ain't no class for it. It's all trial and error. Mm-hmm. And what a lot of people don't realize is you don't get a lot of chances. And it's a very small business. So when you sit down and you're talking to a label head, your name, your stage name, your government name, all of that gets passed down to other labels. Mm-hmm. These other labels, they're not competitors. They're friends. I know they act like they're competitors. They're friends. They're rich. They're corporate devils. They're in each other's pockets. They want to stay rich. So at the end of the day, if you weren't playing ball with them well, then they knew to pass that information along. And another label would pass that information along to them so they didn't waste no time. Because if they can't control you, then there's no point in talking to you.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, you know.
So you didn't sign the deal and you walked out and they basically told you you'll never work and you'll never get a deal.
Yeah. Problem is I signed half the deal.
Okay.
So it was one of them situations.
Okay. So the half that you did sign, what were the consequences for you as an artist behind that?
I was stuck.
Okay.
I was stuck on the shelf, mm-hmm, on that label. And because I pissed them off, they damn sure weren't going to put me out. Mm-hmm. And, you know, trial and error, me learning the business. I was young. Had to realize the hard way. My manager wasn't doing shit. So I had to realize, like, you know, well, how can I get up out of this contract? My manager was a little mad at me, so he wasn't telling me. He wasn't giving me no real information on how to get out of it. So I had to constantly, no joke, I was in that contract, mm-hmm, for many years. Mm-hmm. Many years. Then they would tell you stuff like, we'll put you out. Just record this. Just record that. They give you beats even and tell you to go record a project and give you the false sense that you're all you got to do is do this and then you'll be out of the deal.
Mm-hmm.
Never happened. I recorded so many songs that I can't even touch that you ain't even here. Mm. I can't even give them to you, but I have them on deck. I can't even give them out. I can't play them. I'm legally binded. I can't play those songs that I recorded under Interscope. I can't do it.
Wow.
And then they started telling me, like, once my age got to a certain number and they realized I'm not going to be valuable to nobody else, they start giving you real ways to get out of the contract. Real ways.
Hmm.
Just ghostwrite. Just do this. Just do that for us. And then we'll definitely let you out of the contract. And the older I got, the more business savvy I got, because not only, and I'm sure we'll get into this, but not only was I still doing music the best I could and just doing it my own way and behind the label's back, still releasing music from the trunk, like, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Not telling them. But I was also working in the business. I ended up getting a job in broadcasting. So I was learning more about the business while I was still tied into this fucked up deal.
Yeah.
Like, you know?
Yeah. Wow. So let me ask you this. I know, How was that ghostwriting situation for you? We're not going to give our names and nothing like that, but I know. As an MC, man, and you, did you get to know who you were writing for? Or was it kind of like they was like, write to this, and you just kind of moved on from there?
Yeah, they don't, it's not like you meet the person.
Mm-hmm.
But the way that the label did it for me, they told me, you know, you can get out of the deal. And also they promised me money I never got. But they said that you can get out of this deal as long as you ghostwrite. And let me just tell you something, man. Yeah, I can't drop the name. I still got an NDA on that.
Yeah.
But as far as just letting the listeners know something, because I know a lot of the listeners that listen to this, they like a lot of classic music. Like they like the pioneers, mm-hmm, right? They like the people who started. And this is not dissing anybody. But this whole narrative about how there's these quote legends in the game that write all of their own shit. These MCs that are revered, for writing their own music. Even to this day, if you talk to them, they'll say, you know, well, I write my own shit. They might even say, I don't care that the kids don't write their stuff. Like, you know, it's just something that I like to do. I like to write my own music and this and that. It's just, that's my era.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you something. It's never been, there's never been an era in hip hop where even the most revered MCs wrote their own music.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you did have people that wrote their own stuff. It wasn't 100% broad stroke across the board. But I personally know mad quote MCs that did not write their own shit.
Mm. Yeah.
For a fact.
Yeah.
Mainly because I wrote for one of them and then I had to shut the fuck up about it. And then I had to go on into the business and meeting these people behind the scenes and doing interviews with them because, you know, I worked in the business. So I had to set up interviews with them and do certain things. You get to talking to them and you get to talking to people who represent them and people in labels and people in labels that don't like their job and just people in radio that don't like their job. And then you get to hear all of the different stories. And a lot of that shit will blow your mind. If you don't know too much about what goes on behind the scenes, you'll start to think that some of these people are just bulletproof and everything that they do is like infallible. Right. And that they're just so perfect MCs and all of this stuff. Man, it's not like that. So, yeah, I didn't get to meet the person I wrote for, but I got to, of course, know ahead of time who I was writing for on that song. And there was another prominent MC on that song who is widely regarded as writing their own shit. Mm-hmm. But I got to see the name of the person who was writing for him.
Mm.
So what I did was I dropped a couple, and I know you know because I let you hear it.
I was just about to say that. You dropped some. You left some breadcrumbs out there.
Because I knew nobody would believe me, right? And I had an NDA.
Yeah,
like that's a non-disclosure agreement. So I knew that I couldn't say a lie, right? But if I did end up telling somebody, right, you know, and they wouldn't believe me, I'd be like, well, how about this then?
Yeah,
right. And then so I put a little bit of clues in the verse that I wrote.
Yeah.
But it worked. It years later, it got me out of that deal, right? But I was too old to really at that point, and that was by design on their end, for me to capitalize on too much in the music side of what I was doing.
So you're out of the deal now. You like you said, you working in radio kind of started overlapping towards the end of the, you know, with the contract and everything like that, man. So while working in radio, how was that experience for you coming in? Were you kind of with dealing with the music industry and the business side, were you excited getting into the radio side, or how was that for you? What was you feeling at that point?
At first, just to be honest with you, not good, because I didn't want to do that. I kind of looked at that as defeat. And I'm going to tell you how I did it, because I came into the game solo and I met my boy Jay, and you know, he respected me as an MC, and like, you know, I was teaching him the ropes of how to make music and this and that. And later on down the line, he got in the radio. He got in the radio before me, and he's a few years younger than me. And I wouldn't give up the ghost. Like, you know, I was still, even with a bad contract, I was still making music. Like, you know, I was still going from radio station to radio station, to traveling even overseas and putting all these CDs in the trunk, like, you know what I mean? And trying to get the music out, because I still had that in my mind that no matter what, I'm still going to do what I want to do and ain't nobody going to stop me type shit, right? Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? I always had that anti shit with everything that I was doing. So even though I was getting told this and told that, I was like, you know, fuck you. I'm still going to do what I'm going to do regardless. Like, you ain't going to tell me I can't put my music out and all of this. Take me to court. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? Shit like that. But at the end of the day, I needed to make money. And because I wasn't allowed these avenues and these channels because of some of the bad choices that I made as far as dealing with people and contracts and, you know, saying too much to the wrong person and that kind of shit. I had to take a job in the business. So I had to take a job that I felt like I really didn't want to do at the time. I felt like it was too corporate. And I mean, my boy Jay, Jay Nice, he got me the job. And so at the end of the day, like, it was one of those situations where it was bittersweet. Got me a check in the game. It got me something that, like, I got to learn more about the business.
Mm-hmm.
But I just felt like it wasn't helping me as an artist at first.
Yeah.
As time went on, I started to change my feelings about it because, like, you know, I started to learn more about the business and I started thinking to myself, well, maybe I didn't even want that major deal to begin with, right? So I started taking the job with a grain of salt and just kind of taking what I could get from it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you learned a lot, bro, as far as, because you told me some things that was going on where it was kind of like, well, shit, radio and the record business is the same damn thing behind the scenes.
You know? Yeah. Yeah.
You know? And
Don't realize that.
Yeah, man, because we come from the era, bro, where the DJs, if they like the record, they played it. You know what I'm saying? And then you kind of hit me to the point that it's not like that anymore, man. It's really not like that. Nope. Money talks. You know what I'm saying? And
yep.
It's a lot of shady
stuff. And it hasn't been that way for a long time, too, man. Like, you know, I know a lot of these DJs still claim that they do shit, man. Back in the day, I hate always saying that, but I got to preface that. Like, a long time ago in radio, a DJ would get a record and they would be able to if they wanted to get behind a local record or something, somebody who just drops in a radio station, they would be able to play that record. And then another DJ from a different station would be able to hear that DJ play that song. And then that DJ would pick it up and say, yo, I like, they would contact that DJ or they would contact that station and say, yo, who was that?
Mm-hmm.
Or whatever the case might be, they would find out and they would play that record. And then that's how records used to just catch fire. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I mean? And somebody would be discovered and it would go from east to west coast, from station to station to station, even overseas. But corporations came and squashed all of that bullshit. A lot of people complain about FM radio, and I get it. Trust me. You know, I understand it. I do. Like, you know what I mean? If anybody does, I do. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? And we'll get into the rest of that. But at the end of the day, like, radio was the way at that point to get put on as an artist.
Mm-hmm.
And corporations started to realize that. When they realized that they could put out what people call mainstream commercial music and that the fan base would accept that and not tune that music completely out and say, nah, we want the real shit. Once the fan base was willing to just say, okay, I'll have that in my diet, sure.
Mm-hmm.
Then the corporation said, okay, well, they like that dumb shit. Yeah. So we can come in and produce that dumb shit. Well, let us take control of the radio stations. And that was going on in all the other genres too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Not so much in hip hop for a while. And then they came in and realized that, well, the hip hop fans, just like all the other fans,
mm-hmm.
they'll accept all the dumb shit.
Yeah.
So all of that, well, I'm not going to hate, I just do me, and, like, you know what I mean? And I'm not going to hate on somebody else and what they listen to and all of that PC bullshit got us to where we are now, right? Yeah. Where we just accepted everything for the way it was and we didn't call bullshit back then. Well, them corporations came in and started taking control of all of those radio stations.
Mm-hmm.
They started taking control of Hot 97, Power 105, like, you know, over there in the West Coast, Big Boy and them. They took control of from East to West Coast.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to just call it out. You ain't got to take this, put this part out. WME, William Morris Endeavor, talent agency. That's the secret society to the business. A lot of people want to talk all of this shit about the Illuminati and they don't know what they're talking about. I'm going to tell you this right now. You need to stop talking about the Illuminati and how Hove is a Freemason and all of this other bullshit. That stuff means nothing. You want to know who the real secret society is in the music business, because I cut checks to them from the radio station. I know exactly what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
William Morris Endeavor. And there used to be two, and kind of still is, two talent agencies that are on top of the game. They're the only two that really matter. And it's William Morris Endeavor, which is now, they combined with IMG. So it's WMEIMG and CAA. But right now, you know, William Morris is still killing it.
Yeah.
And anybody that you can think of from even way back then, anybody that you can think of, I mean, literally, you name someone out loud, they're part of William Morris. Like, you know what I'm saying? So that infiltrated into Radio One.
Yeah.
Urban One now. That infiltrated into iHeart. They were the ones that, like, you know, started to pull the strings and everything, not to mention the promo companies.
Mm-hmm.
Because a good artist that would be able to do that, because I used to get artists that came to the station all the time and they would have records for me to try to listen to. And, like, you know, I kept trying to be nice enough to listen to it, because I was the person who had to hear all the bullshit from the artist and then take it upstairs.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I had that kind of job. Like, you know, I had to work the door a lot. So I would hear all this music from the artists who really want to get put on. They just had an honest try. Like, they wanted to, here's my music and this and that. A lot of them wouldn't even have it ready. They wouldn't have the copyrights. They wouldn't have it registered. But aside from that, I would say, listen, you might as well get a promo company before you even walk in this door.
Because
the best you're going to get is a homegrown spin.
Yeah.
That's the best you're going to get. You're going to get a little local spin. You're not going to get this rotation that you think you're going to get just because you got a good record. I don't care how much you think it's good. I can tell you this is good. The DJ upstairs can tell you it's good. It don't matter. He can't get behind it to the point that you want him to, even if he wanted to. He's under contract by a company that's ran by a corporation. Mm-hmm. He starts breaking the rules too much, he gets fired. You know?
Exactly.
So yeah, radio and the music business merged. They was one.
Yeah,
and now these big executives still owe these DJs favors. That's why you see them working for these media brands.
Yeah,
that are since radio's going to this.
It's no coincidence that, like you said, there's only two real major firms, and then there's only like three major labels. It's easy to contact with each other as opposed to before, where you had different labels and different companies and all that kind of stuff. So, and like you said, if you follow the money, a lot of those companies interact with each other, and the money goes to the same companies as well.
Yep. And I'm telling you, you have three major labels right now, and they absorbed all the other labels from the past. So, like, labels like Motown, stuff like that, they all got absorbed. So all of the catalogs that they owned, all them Michael Jackson songs and everything else, they own all of that. All the music from the past to right now consists under three major labels.
Yeah.
And they run everything, including streaming.
Yep.
They run everything.
Yeah. Yeah. And streaming is where me and you got connected, bro. Emilio Egbar, Nonstop Radio, shout out to Emilio. He played that joint that you had out. The Portrait record.
Portrait.
Yeah, and that's when I heard, and I was like, yo, bro, send me that joint. That joint is tough. And then that's when me and you started connecting right there. And then, you know, the beat goes in, started getting birthed from there as being on the show. And you kind of picked up on streaming, and you saw the writing on the wall as far as with FM radio through your segments and everything like that. Talk about that, man. How do you feel now as far as where streaming is going and how online radio is going? What's your thoughts on that?
Oh, man, that's a lot to unpack right there, because streaming in general. So, OK, you have, and a lot of people think just because Jay-Z Hove runs Tidal that it was going to be different than, say, Spotify or Apple Music or something like that. Right. And with the death of iTunes, with the death of MP3 and the fact that nobody else, like, physical copies are gone.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So all that artists have is these streaming services to put their music out on. A lot of it is their fault too, because nobody fought back on it, because everybody wanted to have the latest shit in their phone.
Yeah.
Everybody wanted to keep up with the trends and have the latest shit in their phone, so they didn't look a certain way in front of their friends and all of that type of shit. So they just went along with it. If there was a little bit of fight back, we might not be in this spot.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, the way that streaming services work is, these so-called artists nowadays get fractions of pennies for every stream. Now, the streaming service itself makes anywhere from 75 to 80 cents per stream.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not exaggerating. A lot of people think so. Spotify will pay you like 0.00879. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like a fraction of a penny per stream when they get 75 to 80 cents. Now, that's ludicrous to think about that. That's so crazy that people just accepted that as the new wave. Like, that's the new thing, mm-hmm. is to just accept that your shit is worth less than a penny.
Yeah.
To hear. Yeah. Right. And these, and these artists are so willing to do it because they want to say this sentence right here. I have my music available on all platforms.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I hear it all the time, and God bless them. They sound like an asshole when they say that.
Yeah.
I have my music available on all platforms. Okay. So what does that mean?
Yeah.
What does that mean? It don't mean nothing. And these, and so people found out the hard way, and I predicted it. I called it, what, a year ahead of time, mm-hmm. that these labels pad numbers. And then what, a year later, after I said it, Tidal got bopped and Spotify got bopped, uh-huh. for padding their label. Because at the end of the day, the labels own the streaming services. So people don't realize that there's a such thing as parent companies, shareholders. The people who own the most shares in a company essentially own it. Yeah. I don't care whose name is at the top and says they're a CEO and all of that. Mm-hmm. I don't care about that. The people who own the most shares get to dictate what happens in the company. They're the real owners.
Exactly.
And this information is available to anybody right in your phone. Go to Google and type in the shareholders to any company. You can find it.
Yeah.
Especially the public companies.
Quick example of that is the man, homie that that started Papa John's got put out of his own company because he's a public company. So they fired him. So he
exactly. Yeah, exactly. That's the way it worked. It don't matter who came up with the idea, who initially owned it or whatever. The second that you become publicly traded, or even private companies still run into this because they have backdoor shareholders.
Mm-hmm.
And so at the end of the day, the people who own streaming, all three. So if I'm going to say Apple and Spotify and Tidal are the main ones, all of them are owned by major labels, which means they have major label interests, mm-hmm. which doesn't include you, indie artists. And I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be a dickhead when I say that. It doesn't include you. It's their artists.
Mm-hmm.
They're padding their numbers. They're the ones that are padding. So it came out that what, Beyonce and who else? Ross. There was a lot of people that it came out that they had illegitimate numbers.
Mm-hmm.
It was getting padded up. And they don't care if you pad your numbers because they have people that work for them 24/7 padding the numbers in their basement all day.
Mm-hmm.
24/7. They're able to pad their numbers way more than an indie artist is able to pad their numbers and get fake bots and all of that stuff to pad the numbers. It doesn't matter. I get told all the time by artists, you know, when I'm in these meetings and everything, that I got this many streams, I got that many streams. It don't matter how many streams you got, numbers. And that goes back to my initial point about how, like, you know, it used to matter how many numbers that you used to bring into these labels and talk to them. Like, it used to matter about that.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter anymore. Those numbers don't matter. You could say that you have 1 million streams on a song, 3 million streams on a song. They're going to look at you. Okay? It don't matter because they don't know if you've padded your own numbers. Here's what it comes down to. You can talk all this shit about how much you got all these streams and people press like on your fucking social media post and all of that shit.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the day, can you put asses in seats? If you were to have a show, if you were to perform, how many people would come based on that?
Yeah.
How many people, I don't care if you have 3 million streams, how many of them streams is going to follow your ass to the thing and sit down and watch you perform and pay at the door? How many? Mm-hmm. Because most people, none. Those social media likes don't translate to asses in seats.
Mm-hmm.
So those streaming numbers don't translate to asses in seats. And I'm sorry to tell these indie artists nowadays, that shit still matters. Because you ain't no goddamn artist if you ain't performing in front of people. If you don't take your ass off of IG and go on stage, and then you're not an artist. Sorry, you're not. You're not an artist.
Yeah.
You're a wannabe. You're online and you're performing for your fucking following, hoping they press like.
Yeah.
I on your them, social media post.
I call them glorified hobbyists. That's what I call them.
Exactly. And so, that's fucked up the business.
Yeah. Yeah. Would you say that's your biggest pet peeve right now as far as where the industry is at? People just really don't take this serious, man. They just want the likes.
Yeah. Because I deal with it so much. Mm-hmm. I deal with it so much. When I'm sitting down, because I still work with artists.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting down in these meetings, like, you know, I provide services to artists. So, like, you know, I had to stop fucking with rappers.
Yeah.
As much as like that, because that's where I come from, hip hop. So it sounds bad for me to say that. But I had to stop fucking with them. There ain't no more music in hip. All right. Without me talking shit about the current state of hip hop, right, which I want to do. But at the end of the day, the state of the business there, if we only talk about the business aspect mm-hmm. of hip hop, it's gone. There's no more money in it because people want to talk all of this shit. And I'm going to just say it now. People want to talk about all of this shit about how we don't need the major labels. We can just do everything independent. We don't need to worry about, like, you know, what the major labels are doing and all of this kind of thing. We can go around them. Mm-hmm. We have social media. We have this. We have that, which is all true. That's all true. You have social media. You can get and all of that. But do you? That's the thing. Do you? Because try to get two rappers to agree on something.
Yeah.
You're a DJ, fam. I know you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Yeah.
These people act like there's going to be some underground revolution where everybody bands together and makes a second music industry.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen.
Yeah.
The people that are still in control of the music industry have been forever and will be. When everyone who's listening to this right now, when your grandkids die and have grandkids, the same people that are in control of this music business, it's going to be their children's that are in control of that shit.
Mm-hmm.
And ain't nobody going to stop them. Ain't nobody going to do shit about it. The best that we can do is try to get them, put pressure on them, because they do respond to pressure. They're about money. They're about where it's going to go next. They do respond to pressure. Anything that's going to affect the way that the bottom line moves, they'll listen.
Mm-hmm.
If a big enough campaign was put against them to do right and make better music and do this and do that and be for the artists, they would be forced to listen. Now, would they go all the way? That would be dependent on the people who are fighting back.
Mm-hmm.
But there ain't no fight back because everybody's been programmed to be on their phone 24/7 and to just get social media likes. People think likes pay bills. I'd like to see that.
Uh-huh.
Like, likes don't pay bills, right? And likes don't do a goddamn thing for you as an artist. I know you think it does because you think somebody heard your song, and now what? Now what?
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing. Now what? So when people spam their links and they @sign people all day on social media, they just their music and this and that. What's that doing for you?
Mm-hmm.
It's making you look desperate, number one. It's making you look like an asshole, number two. What did it do? It did nothing. It did absolutely nothing to further you as an artist. Those people that press like, they're not going to come see you. And then you might say to yourself, well, I don't plan on performing. And then I would say, you're not an artist then. Stop.
Yeah.
Stop. Yeah. Right? So, yeah, people who don't take this shit seriously, there's not going to be a revolution of people banding together to make a second music industry. There's one music business and there's one music industry.
Yep.
Now, this is coming from a person who's the most anti-industry motherfucker that you could possibly talk to. I'm anti-everything. Right. And I get criticized from the people who, like, you know, been biting my segment and talking shit online about me. You know, but maybe not everybody else know. Mm-hmm. I get a lot of blowback for what I do, both from the corporations in the music. There's a lot of people that hate me inside the business.
Yeah.
Inside the music industry, I get hated on by a lot of executives, by a lot of people that have money and power. Right. Mm-hmm. And then I also get it from the average rapper who wants to disagree with what I say because what I say sounds like work.
Yeah.
Right? You know what I mean? So they want to argue with me because they don't want to go outside. They don't want to perform. They don't want to do all of the things like copyright and register your music for track airplay, because they're like, why I need to do that? I can just post my track online and I can just at sign a bunch of fucking people and I can get likes. And then I'll put it up on Spotify. I'll do this. I'll do that. I'll sign up for DistroKid or TuneCore or whatever. Those third-party distributors, a lot of y'all live by them. They're about to go into business with the major labels anytime now. I can't wait, because a lot of y'all motherfuckers that disagree with me about everything and you like, well, I distribute my own music. I put it on TuneCore. I do this. I do that. Okay. First of all, what does that do? Okay, they put it on Spotify for you because Spotify kicked y'all asses off, which I told everybody was going to happen. Spotify kicked y'all asses off because y'all lazy and y'all ain't doing nothing to make it worth Spotify to keep you on there. You got to show value to a corporation to keep you on there. They got to see the bottom line for having your lazy ass on there. Mm-hmm. You put it on there and expected a corporation to do all the work for you. Okay, so then you go through TuneCore and you go through DistroKid, all of this shit. You get your music up on streaming. Now what? Mm-hmm. People can press like on it on social media when you post a link. Okay, now what? Didn't do nothing. Got you some fractions of pennies that you're going to owe back, because you're going to owe that back with interest. Because all of that gets tracked by the IRS. And they waiting for y'all to make a certain amount, and they're going to hit y'all with some paperwork in the mail. Not to mention stupid motherfuckers that post shit with uncleared samples. And this is why knowing the business is so important. So when I hear somebody say they have all these streams and all of that, and then I listen to their shit, and then I say simple shit, like, is this copyright?
Yeah.
Huh? Is this registered for track airplay? What does that mean? Oh, because I hear a sample, like, yeah. Is that clear?
Yeah.
What does that mean? Okay, so you didn't even clear the sample. You didn't do none of that.
Yeah.
That, okay, so these major labels that own everything. So whatever song that you sampled, a major label owns it. So they also own the streaming service. Stupid motherfuckers. They also own the streaming service. So they have bots that are hooked up to their streaming service that just randomly check for uncleared samples and so on. And they might not even hit you right away. They're patient. They want that long money. They'll wait and see if you actually get a hit before they come for a lot of that money. And the second that they see the right lane to come and collect their money, they're going to, because these bots check for all of them samples that are uncleared and everything like that. And when you don't got your business right, and when you're not treating it like a profession, because it is, I don't care how many, you know, bathroom rappers that there are these days. I don't care. It's still a profession. Music, making music is a business. That's why they call it the music business. It's a profession. So these people that don't treat it like such, it will come back to bite them. But the problem with the music business and the people that don't treat it the way that everyone else treats a profession, like, you don't see doctors acting like this, right? You don't see somebody walk into a hospital and just put on a white coat and go into surgery and be like, yo, I got this.
Yeah.
And they'd be like, hold on, who the fuck are you? Like, you know what I mean? Are you a doctor? Nah, I mean, kind of, like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
What the fuck? Like, you know what I mean? Nah, I'm just like, you know, I got some likes when I put this coat on. Like, you know what I mean? Nah, I got this, right? You don't see that. You only see it with this music shit because it gets them attention. Gets everybody these endorphins when they get likes online and everything like that. Makes them feel like they special and shit. But you're only special when you prove it. When you're willing to put the work in. And the fucked up part about the music business part is when you got all of these other people doing bad business and fucking it up, that fucks it up for everybody else. That fucks it up for the people who are willing to put all the work in. There's artists right now that got the copyrights, that got it registered for track airplay, that go and they go on stage and they got talent.
Yeah.
But you know why they can't move the way they should? Because there's too many people that are faking it. There's too many people that just do it for likes and attention. And it's the fucked up part. And a lot of people want to say this PC bullshit. And you know, I said it a lot where I hate these like inspirational quote motherfuckers that just want to talk and say shit like a fucking quote.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? They want to treat this shit like it's some kind of fucking Tumblr quote. Like, you know what I mean? Nah, I mean, shit, if you good, and then it's going to show. Mm-hmm. And then you're going to get what you put back, all this shit. Like, you know what I mean? Doing the others, they just shut the fuck up, man. None of that shit applies to the music business. And if you spent 30 fucking minutes in the music business in any way, you would understand that.
Yeah.
You would understand that when you have all of these hobbyists fucking shit up for everybody else.
Yeah.
That's a real thing. It's a real thing.
Yeah.
So the money in hip hop got taken away because there's so many fake artists that don't take it seriously. They don't want to do the paperwork. They don't want to clear samples. They don't want to get on stage or get copyrights or really even understand. I hear a lot of people bitching that radio don't play their music.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, okay, now we can talk about that because I don't like radio either. Like, you know what I mean? But I'm coming from a unique perspective because I worked in it.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I got best friends that are in it still. But at the end of the day, you can't complain that radio ain't playing your shit. When I ask you, do you have it copyrighted? No. Is it registered for track airplay? No. Then shut the fuck up. You have no right to bitch.
Yeah.
You have no right to complain about the state of the industry and how FM radio and commercial outlets do not serve you as an artist when you don't serve yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You need to shut the fuck up and fall to the back because it's because of you that radio doesn't play motherfuckers music anymore. Real shit. It's because of you. There's no way the lobbies fill up with people in radio stations. They fill up with a bunch of idiots that don't take shit seriously. They just want to go and threaten the DJ or press them or say, play my shit, play this, play that, play this.
Mm-hmm.
And none of them have their shit together. There's a lot of people that just want to stalk their local DJ online, hit their Facebook up, hit the Twitter, like, you know what I mean? You ain't playing nobody's shit. Da, 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 da. But they don't have their shit registered for track, their player copyright. They don't own their own shit.
Yeah.
And they want radio to do what? Do everything for you? Nah, that's not the way anything works in life. Grow up.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Get a job, because you're never going to make it in music. Sorry.
I know you said that you, you know, that's what you're doing now, is you're kind of mentoring and working with artists now who are ready for that type of thing.
Yeah.
Talk about that, man.
I'm trying to help get them ready. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So are you picking them up like at the beginning of their career, or what's kind of like when you're taking them into your little boot camp there? What stage in their career are they in?
Well, it started out. I started to like, we offered services where, like, you know, it'd be a certain amount if you already had music done and recorded and ready and registered and copyright and all of that. And maybe you already had it up on streaming and whatever. We used to offer a certain amount just to get it into the right hands where then your music can actually chart and be on the Nielsen charts, which is, by the way, how anybody has ever had a charted song in their whole life. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I mean, Aretha Franklin, right? Like, as far back as you want to go, like, the Nielsen charts dictate where you are on the charts. That's Billboard. Nielsen reports to Billboard. So if you don't have your music registered for track airplay, BDS, Media Base, if you don't have your music registered with these things, you are not reporting your music to Billboard, which means you will never chart, right? So I used to try to have artists, like, you know, just pay a certain amount, and they used to come in and like, you know, if they was at a certain level, we'd try to get them to the next level. But that got to be a little much in the meetings, because people would come in and they would be lying to me when I used to say, you know, well, is it ready? Like, do you have your music registered? Do you have it copyrighted? And there's ways to look it up, and they don't know that. So, like, you know, it turned into me being a lie detector test.
Mm-hmm.
For a line of artists that are in front of me, and I got to try to find the ones that are serious. Like, you know what I mean? And because I got a password for BDS. You work inside radio. Like, you know, my homie gives me his password because he works in radio still. Like, when you work in radio, you're still able to go on and check if a person has their shit registered. Like, you know what I mean? And and ready to go. You know what I mean? So when they would come up and they would say, oh yeah, it's all ready. They just, what they wanted me to do was just do everything for them.
Yeah.
But they could tell that I wouldn't do that had they not had their shit ready. So they would just lie.
Yeah.
So it turned into me having to be a lie detector test, man. And I ain't got time for all that shit. So what I started to do now is I take artists from the ground up, you know, and I get them before they ever made their first song. You know what I mean? And it's mainly singers that I deal with. I can't deal with rappers. Number one, because I want to make money.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody that says, like, you know, I hear you say it all the time in your interviews, like, why'd you start making music, right? And then somebody will answer your question and they'll lie to you.
Mm-hmm.
They'll say, because I love making music. That's a lie.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they loved making music. That's not what I'm calling a lie. That's not why they started. They started making music because they wanted to put it out. They seen something on TV or they heard it on the radio. They admired it and they wanted to do that.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted a certain level of fame. They wanted a certain level of money, no matter how big or small that might be. And they wanted something when they went into it. It wasn't just because maybe that's a happy byproduct. Maybe you do like to make music and all of that. Maybe that's a happy byproduct, but it's a business.
Mm-hmm.
And somewhere in the psyche, in the psyche, they knew that. That's why they started. Because I can answer that question for anybody you'll interview tomorrow, next day, when you say, what made you start the music? Because they wanted money. Because they wanted to become famous. They wanted credit.
Yeah.
They wanted a pat on the back. And you know what? That's not bad. That's not a bad thing. Because you want to ask me that? Okay, yeah. I wanted to become famous. I wanted money. I wanted to get it going. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to do what I know how to do well and get a lot of credit and money and fame for it.
Yeah.
Period. But that's the truth. People don't like to say the truth nowadays. Like, you know, we have all these fake woke people and fake conscious motherfuckers, but they can't tell you something simple as the truth.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? So, yeah, I mean, I take these artists and they'll lie to me and tell me, you know, that they just want to do it for the music. And I'll say, okay, well, I can't fuck with you then.
Yeah.
And then they'll look at me and I'll be like, oh, because I want to make money. So if you don't want to make money, and then you're going to fuck my paycheck up.
Yeah.
And then they kind of like look at me like, oh, I can just tell you the truth. And I'm like, yeah. Okay, I just want to make money then. Like, yeah, I want to get, okay, well then we can work with that.
Mm-hmm.
You
mm-hmm.
just want to make music, then go ahead. What you need me for?
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Motherfuckers be lying. You know what I'm saying? It's just the truth.
Yeah, man. I hear that, bro, man. But yo, man, you know me and you can go on this all day, bro. So we're gonna have to bring you back for another one, man. Definitely. And how can they get in contact with you, man? If you got artists out there who are really interested in it and they want to make money, they want to do it the right way, what's the best way to get a hold of you and your team?
You can hit me up social media, Divine Thought TM or The Beat Goes In.
Mm-hmm. And The Beat Goes In, man, is definitely a dope segment, man. And like I said, I appreciate, you know, what you do. And like I said, I get a lot of responses on from the artists who really listen to it and they take those notes, man. And they always tell me, man, tell that dude we appreciate him for what he does, man. So we just gotta figure out a way to get you monetized for that, man. You know what I'm saying?
I appreciate you hosting the segment, fam. Like, I appreciate you hosting the segment. I appreciate everybody that reaches out and tells me, like, you know, they enjoyed it and everything. But I do, before I get off here, I want to send a big fuck you out to the people who bit my segment, who monitored my pages and just wanted to go ahead and take everything I say and act like it's a lane, just taking what I say, like try to create their own lane off what I do and all of that. Like, you know, shout out to the UK, shout out to the Bronx, motherfuckers that want to take my shit and everything. Nah, for real though. Like, you know what I mean? I do appreciate y'all, because what you're doing is you just motivating me to be a better version of what I got to do with the content.
Uh-huh.
So I do appreciate y'all bum-ass motherfuckers that want to take my shit and everything else. Uh-huh. Like, you know what I mean? And shout out to you, because you have a dope platform. And there's a lot of people that are biting what you do too, fam. There's a lot of people
I know it.
That are biting what you do as a platform, and they want to, they heard what you do and they want to do their own version of what you do instead of the best version of what they can do. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So shout out to us.
Yeah, but I've seen those platforms who bite the thing couldn't even make it a full year. So I don't worry about them. It takes a lot of commitment to do what we do, bro. A lot of commitment.
Exactly.
Dope, man.
So let me ask you this real quick, man.
As an artist right now, man, what would be your approach in the industry as far as putting out your music? What would be your game plan with you having all the knowledge and all of that?
Okay, well, what I would do, which is what I'm telling the artists to do now, you can't just tell yourself that you know everything. So, number one, stop lying to yourself. Stop saying that what you're doing right now is good when you're complaining about what's going on with your whole shit. Like, you know what I mean? So, if you got the room to complain, then you got the room to grow. So, number one, be humble, right? That's the first thing. Understand, take a look at what you're doing, and understand the landscape of what it is now. And everything is digital. Everything has to be at everybody's fingertips, right? So what I would tell people to do is, especially if you're a rapper right now, what you want to do is be more than that. Stop being just a rapper. You're not going to go anywhere with being just a rapper. You got to be more than that. You got to be more than just an artist in general. So if you sing and if you rap, whatever you do, you got to be a brand. Mm-hmm. You have to be a brand. So what you got to do is you got to do touring. You got to go tour. You got to have merchandise. You got to be in people's faces. You got to give them a reason to like what you do over all of that commercial shit, right? Because people want to claim all of this independent shit and everything else that they're doing right now. Okay, well, if you want to actually be independent, which you can't be, which is one thing I didn't mention. There's no such thing as independent artists nowadays. Don't care what people tell me because you have your music up on streaming, which is owned by major labels. So basically, you got a bad record deal whenever you put your music up on streaming services. So stop saying you're independent. You're not. You can be as independent as you can be in nowadays and in this day and age. But that would be if you really took yourself seriously. And let's say you got a Patreon account. That's what I tell everybody to do, is get a Patreon account, have some exclusive material behind the scenes of you going on stage, whatever you're doing. It could be just you busting it up behind the scenes of whatever it is that you're doing, have exclusive content only on Patreon and sites like that where you can crowdfund and grow your own brand. Like, you know, you cannot just expect that you're going to make good music and say that's all I got to do is make good music. Everybody, there are so many people that have good music. I hear singers all the time that say, you know, they're better than Beyonce or something, like, you know what I mean? And they could be, but at the end of the day, that don't mean shit.
Yeah.
Because that's only like, that's 30, making music is 30% of what you got to do. 70% of making music is the business. So if you don't have a brand in 2020 and beyond, if you don't have a brand, you don't have nothing.
Yeah.
So my advice, my best advice would be humble, be honest with yourself, stop lying, go on Patreon or sites like that, create a brand, get merch. Don't just get a logo put on the front of the shirt with a decal and an iron on. Take some time. Have some integrity. Everybody else has that basic shit. Look at what everybody else is doing and do better. Right, take some time, find the right people to press your merch up and do whatever you got to do and be a brand, be distinctive, get in people's face and let them know you're good.
There you go, man. Brother, man, thank you for everything you do, man. Thank you for teaming up with us, man. And we, like I said, we got to figure out some things here to really help you win, man, because I appreciate what you're doing, man, and we're working behind the scenes to figure something out. So definitely appreciate you.
I appreciate you, man. I appreciate everything, fam. Thank you.
Shout out to the haters and shout out to the haters, right?
Yeah. Shout out to y'all.
Yeah. So how about this, man? Let's how about we play that joint that introduced me to Devonto? Let's play the portrait, man. I love that joint. I love spinning that joint.
The portrait.
Yeah, man. It's a dope record, brother. So get into the portrait. We'll be right back. It's the mixtape show, man. Peace out, bro. See you in a little bit.
All right. Peace.